Good morning.
Hello.
Hello, Chris.
How are we all?
Wet after being out with the dog. If you're watching in a sunny climate, viewer, it is throwing it down of rain in Dorset today, at the moment.
And Polly's passing on her wet paws to Deb.
Yeah.
Yeah, good old Polly. Hello, Polly. Good to see you again. I'm pleased that you deigned to show yourself this week. Oh, yes.
Hello.
It's good to see you as well, Deb, of course. You know.
Always the afterthought.
There we are.
Dogs are like that, aren't they?
They are. They are. Yeah. My dog's very
the
wet.
The pecking order is Chris, Polly, Deb. It's fine. No, I know my place.
Yeah, I know. There we are. Well, another week has passed and we're back together again for a jolly presentation of some understanding of something in the Bible.
Do you think we ought to know what's in the Bible? Or should we just make it up when we read it?
Well, don't you most weeks, Chris?
That would be telling.
I know. That's very true. We have a conundrum, dear viewer, because the reading from the Gospel, which we tend to work from, is yet another telling of the story of the Transfiguration. And the three of us are a bit tired of talking about the Transfiguration. So we've tried to consider another approach, haven't we, Chris?
Are we going to go for another live vote?
Another live vote, yeah. Live vote, Chris. Go for it.
So the choice is, do we go for the Transfiguration or do we go for the New Testament reading, which is from Paul's letter to the Corinthians? Lines are open now for 20 seconds.
Oh, the votes are pouring in, Chris, I can see. Oh, Transfiguration is not getting many votes at the moment.
And what's the votes like in Bridport End?
They like the Transfiguration in Bridport, but they also like the new the Corinthians, 2 Corinthians, so they're on the fence.
I've got some news typed in, couldn't we have something from Peter Rabbit?
And voting is now closed.
Good. Well done, Chris.
I can now declare that the results of the votes are we want to hear something about St. Paul.
Oh,
no. The Corinthians.
Oh, thank heavens for that. It has been independently verified, this vote, hasn't it, Chris?
Yes.
Polly verifies it.
Yeah.
Polly was our verifier.
Yeah, she is.
So there we are. So perhaps we need to have a pause.
Do you want to pause?
Pause.
There you are.
Who was going to read, did we?
Well, do you want me to read? I'll read for a change, if you like.
Go on, then. Okay. Go on, then, Polly.
So this reading is from the second letter to the Corinthians, chapter 4, beginning to read at verse 3. And even if our gospel is veiled, it is veiled to those who are perishing. In their case, the God of this world has blinded the minds of the unbelievers to keep them from seeing the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God. For we do not proclaim ourselves. We proclaim Jesus Christ as Lord and ourselves as your slaves for Jesus' sake. For it is the God who said, "Let light shine out of the darkness," who has shone in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ.
Yeah, that's very typical of Paul, that is, isn't it?
It is. It is.
And you can see why it's put with the gospel reading.
Mm-hmm.
Of the
veiling.
Yes.
Veiling, yes. It's as you say, Chris, it is typical of Paul. And we have to bear in mind that by the time we get to his second letter, is in effect writing back to them to tell them off for not following the way that he's already advised them to do in the first place, if my memory serves me right. And so here we are at a point when he's saying, come on, you've got to understand what it is I'm telling you. You can't keep up with this.
I was always amazed, just a bit of background, on the size of the church in Corinth.
Yeah, I've never been, but yeah.
No, I've never been. I'm just remembering what one of my lecturers said.
Oh.
Because I've always imagined Corinth as this huge city in Greece.
Mm.
Yeah.
And so therefore we imagined a huge thriving church with thousands of people going. But I can't remember who it was saying that the likely size of the church was probably about 50 or 60 people that Paul's writing to.
I think we have to remember that a lot of the collected people, which we would refer to as churches, Paul would have, called followers of the way or whatever they became known as, could have just been as few as two or three meeting in somebody's house, couldn't they?
Yeah.
And so 50 was rather a large gathering if there were 50 there. But they'd probably taken over the temple that was there anyway, hadn't they?
Yeah, and it was also probably only three or four families.
Mm. Which, of course, included their servants who had to go along whether they wanted to or not.
Well, that's right. And therefore, when you get the discord that you have, that's the sort of thing he was trying to address.
Ooh.
It was orderly behaviour. But in typical Paul fashion, I mean, I just think it can get so exciting. You know, we do not proclaim ourselves. We proclaim Christ as Lord and ourselves as slaves for Jesus Christ's sake. I mean, it's real dedication and excitement for what he's doing. You know, let light shine out of darkness. Well, goodness me, that's a hard task sometimes, isn't it?
Yes, it is.
You know,
but then the next part of that sentence, who has shone in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God. I guess it's saying, you know, it's not us, but God shining in us. I think that's hard, but I think sometimes we think we've got to make the light ourselves. I think maybe we make it harder. Well, I do anyway. I'm just speaking for myself because I find it hard.
I think it's quite a bit about, that God has blinded the minds of the unbelievers to keep them from seeing the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God. Why would God blind them to understanding him? Surely the only way they're going to become believers is by having some, understanding or sight for themselves. But then Paul goes on, of course, we don't proclaim ourselves, we proclaim Jesus Christ. And I guess if they're not proclaiming Jesus Christ, then their minds are veiled to a degree. And I think it's a bit back to what you said last week, Chris, when we read that John 1 passage again. You suddenly realise that, I think I'm maybe misusing your words, that Jesus was there in the beginning with God.
Yeah. Like you say, I like that point that Deb just said, actually. It's so easy at times for us to try and shine as the light. But Paul here is really adamant. It's actually all we are trying to do is to point to the light of Jesus.
Yeah.
And often the more we try and do it, the more we promote ourselves, that's what brings in the veiling.
Yeah.
And the more we try and promote ourselves and say, I know it, I've got it right, on goes the veils, and people stop seeing the light of Jesus. And I think that's when the people are perishing, and probably where that veiling comes from in that first verse.
So that's interesting what you say, Chris. I saw this morning when I was for something else on the phone, there was a tweet Twitter remark, or what they call it, X remark now, I guess, from Martin Percy, who could well have been your principal at Correctly. And he was responding to some statement from Truro Diocese, who were trying to pull the wool over people's eyes about what oversight ministry is, as opposed to the ministry that perhaps we would see ourselves doing. And Truro Diocese said that oversight ministry is really just us, the priests of that diocese, bringing people to know, to have a greater understanding of the need to tell people about Jesus for themselves. And Martin Percy wasn't very encouraging about that kind of comment, as you know him better than I ever do. He probably wouldn't be. But there is this confusion of what is the role of the parish priest? What is the role of all of the lay people? But how do we do what we do together? Because actually our role all together is to bring people to see the light of Christ in their lives, surely.
I wonder about, you know, even if our gospel is veiled, it is veiled to those who are perishing. I think we get into a mindset in the church of thinking that that Paul is talking about everybody outside the church. And I don't think that is what Paul is saying at all. I think we are very, very easily guilty of being the ones for whom the gospel is veiled. And, you know, when then he talks about, you know, the light being in people, and it's the light that comes from God, you know, we have this conversation so many times, don't we, about, you know, people who live a life of light and yet they're not in the church. And that is a bit of a conundrum, but I think it's not in and out. It's God works differently than that. And I think Paul is saying something about that. And it's interesting if we read it like, well, we know and we just need to tell everybody else and then they'll know. Because we know in different ways. We don't know necessarily through brain power. Sometimes you know things in a completely different way. And this is a lot deeper. And I think the idea of light and darkness is a really wonderful image, which is used a lot in scripture, obviously, because it isn't about, you know, learning something and then you've got it and that's it. Light and dark comes and goes, doesn't it? Sometimes I feel in the darkness, and it's not to do with, you know, having it and having it forever. It's about life. It's about the way we live.
Yeah, I'd agree, Deb. And I mean, the thing is, there are different depths of light and dark as well, aren't there? If you want to be really philosophical, I guess, about, you know, because even in the light, you can feel sometimes in the darkness. And I think this reading for me has always meant something about how we know Jesus within our hearts. You know, how close are we? Because there are times when all of us, doesn't matter whether you're ordained or not ordained, there are times when you feel distance from God, or you're not absolutely certain because of the things that life throw at us all from time. And it is that for me, that, you know, sometimes my heart feels desperate, you know, when I'm dealing with a situation that is out of my knowledge base or out of my ability to change. We want to change things for the better for people, but we know we can't do that, and we certainly can't do it alone, but for the grace of God, of course. And I think the point you make is very profound.
Could I read a little poem?
Oh, yes, do.
Oh, it's not really a poem. It's called a quatrain.
Oh.
It says, "I am not defined by darkness," confided the night. "At dawn, I am reminded, I am defined by light."
Where's that from, Chris?
It's a poet called Lem Sisse.
Oh, I love Lem Sisse.
I got given a book of... He writes a little quatrain like that every day. I got given a book of quatrains, and I actually used it for the basis of my Rambling Rectorate Parish magazine last month, or this month.
You did? I read it.
It's really interesting. I just thought it's one of those quatrains that the more you read it and think about it, the deeper it gets. Mm. And it really is a case of even the night knows it's defined by light.
Yeah.
Does the day light know it's confined by darkness? So that's the alternative, isn't it?
Well, I'd probably put my science head on then.
Go for it, Chris.
Because darkness is an absence of light. There's no such thing as darkness.
Ah, there we are.
Just an absence of light. And actually, I think even that works exactly what Paul's saying here. You know, we become dark and evil and horrible when light is absent. And if God is love, that means love is absent. And it's the absence of love that makes people turn to dark things.
But then I think darkness sometimes can be a positive thing, in that sometimes you need that in order to see the light. You know, the whole thing about the dark night of the soul, where, you know, it's a struggle, but it's not forever. And yeah. The absence, you know, the idea of the absence of God, the absence of light, you know, people who've struggled with faith, and I think everyone struggles with faith, you know, sometimes it's in the darkness, it's in the absence where God feels far away, that you kind of realize the end of your own efforts, and the light comes, and God is there even when you don't know or even want God. So I think darkness, I can't remember where it's from, but there's a lovely line I've used in Lent before about the knowing the treasures in the darkness, and sometimes those dark times reveal a lot to you and the light comes. I'm not as gifted as you, Chris. I haven't got those words, but I think the darkness will always be overcome by the light, and I think it's hard to always acknowledge it, but I believe it's true.
And I think we've also got to, again, we like to live in a binary world, light and dark.
Yeah, exactly. But
what's reality? You get the first light of the morning, you get twilight, you get dawn, you get dim, dull, cloudy days.
Mm.
You know, you can get bright, starry nights.
Yes, you can.
With the moon shining bright.
Yeah.
So, you know, light and dark has grey in it of all shades.
Mm.
And sometimes, you know, like you say, so sometimes we can be bright and shining and a cloud just comes over. Sometimes we can feel like we're walking in the pitch black and then we just get this tiny little glimpse, which I suppose is the sort of thing we do on the fourth Sunday of Lent, isn't it? We change our purple to pink or to rose just to try and get that little glimpse of the glory that's to come in amongst our Lenten disciplines.
Mm.
And, you know, it's just a little glimpse of what the light is there. So don't think that we always have to have this big, bright, shining light, which is quite interesting because I normally put a light on the front of my face, and I've just realised that 2 minutes before we started recording, this little light bulb went pop.
Oh.
So yeah, this light bulb is no longer shining the light.
I'm always interested how we have over centuries come to associate evil with darkness alone.
Yeah.
Because we all know that there's just as much evil in the daytime or the light as there is in the darkness. And I guess this is where it would have been useful to have had our former curate Fiona with us, because she wrote her MA dissertation on John of the Cross and those people and their understanding of darkness and light. So I'm sure she would have filled our head with so much stuff we'd have been left floundering. And there we are. Mm. Well, I hope, dear viewers, you found that interesting. And thank you for choosing that on the vote and for Polly for verifying that it was what we needed. And if you really want to know about the Transfiguration, then all you need to do is turn to chapter 9 of Mark's Gospel and you'll find it there. But excellent. Well, yeah,
I think maybe reading the Transfiguration after thinking about that passage that we've just discussed will illuminate it, don't you?
Hopefully. Hopefully. Lift it.
I like your choice of word, Deb.
And lift it. I do have to say, as we come to an end, Chris, that the absence of the light bulb hasn't spoiled us seeing you and picking up your and picking up your brighter side as well. So there we are. It's not shining off the palette, so we're okay. So we're okay. Lovely, dear viewer, and thank you very much again as ever. You found us, so you know where we are. Do encourage other people maybe to have a look in. Are the Spanish contingents still out there, Chris, or are they back?
No, they're out there until the weather warms up.
And I'm not quite sure whether Patty's back in upstate New York. I've seen one or two comments from her. She may be well back now. And if she is, please, she had a safe journey to get back there. And everybody else who may be watching, whether near or far, we thank you for giving up the time to be with us. Thank you to Harry, as ever, for putting this up putting up with us. Yeah, absolutely. Oh, there we are. Are you back next week, Deb? It's off term. That doesn't affect you anymore, I guess, like me.
No, I'll be here.
You'll be here. Chris, off term doesn't affect you, does it?
Nope, I'll be here.
Excellent. Doesn't affect me either, half term. Not anymore. So there we are. Thank you all very much. See you all soon.
Yep.
Bye-bye.
Bye. Bye.